I would congratulate the Ministry and the University of Istanbul, Sahid, for their very visionary enterprise in setting up a film archive and museum, and which undoubtedly will be a very valuable resource for scholars and historians, not just of cinema, but of cultural practices in general. So, since one doesn't often get the opportunity to present a conference paper in a room with a grand piano, in such a historic place as the Radio and Broadcasting Institute, I thought I would start with a little musical anecdote. So I arrived from India, which is some 4,000 miles away, a couple of days ago, and I was standing in the balcony of my hotel in Fatih, which is a beautiful part of Istanbul, and I heard a very familiar tune. And this was a melody of a song called Avaram. Yeah, okay, great. So, from a 1956 Hindi film, or Indian film, or Hindi film, because we have films made in 30 languages, that was being played by two musicians, one on percussion, one on a wind instrument of some sort, who were walking down the street. And I'm glad that many of you recognize that song, because I believe that Raj Kapoor was the actor in this film called Avara, was a very popular actor in the 1950s and 60s in Turkey, and in fact, I believe the film was adapted into Turkish as well. So for me, hearing the strains of a familiar melody in a distant land was a striking sensory experience, bridging time, space, and culture through cinema. And this is something that I have in mind when I use the word spilling over of the archive. So what doesn't remain contained within the archives of cinema, and I hope to get to that through during my presentation. I'm extremely grateful to Professor Nezi Erdoğan, Dr. Jaran Balan, the rector of the University of Istanbul, Seir, who was tremendously helpful with getting my visa, and the faculty from the Department of Film and Television for inviting me to this symposium to deliver a keynote. And I must admit, I feel quite undeserving of this great honor, especially given the eminence of the other two keynotes, Professor Ian Christie and Professor Thomas Elsasser, whose work I have studied and taught with great admiration and respect, and who have been, or who are, larger-than-life figures within the disciplines of film and media studies. I was jokingly saying to Professor Christie earlier that both he and Professor Elsasser are older than the country of my birth, India. So I very much appreciate the risky generosity of the organizers of the symposium in entrusting a younger academic like myself with the responsibility of a keynote, and I hope I can do some justice to it. Although this symposium is on film archives, when Janan sent me the concept note, the title read Forgetting the Archive, and so I've taken that quite seriously. So my presentation is only tangentially about film archives. It's more broadly about historiography as a practice that emerges out of the archive. Therefore, I beg the indulgence of archivists and film activists in discussing what may seem as a slightly off topic in some sense. What I want to talk about today is the possibility for plural imaginaries. Plural imaginaries of archives, of history, of historiography, and of time. My central point is that different cultures and languages have developed different conceptions of and relationships to history, the narration of history, ideas of time, and therefore the idea of archives. My objective is to initiate some sort of a collective conversation towards introducing some of these plural imaginaries into the archives and museums that we are constructing and the histories and film histories that we are writing. And Professor Erdoğan has already set the ball rolling in his wonderful presentation this morning. So I'm going to mainly draw upon examples from Indian moving image cultures in my presentation. And I use the term moving image quite deliberately because I'll be showing examples from cinema, video art, and also some television news coverage. So conventionally, in critical theory and in archival practice, archives have been imagined as closed buildings with rows and rows of dusty shelves holding precious boxes of indexed and classified material that function as a secret DNA to knowledge and therefore power. In the context of a film archive, the dusty shelves would include film prints, publications, media reports, photographs, and so on. The presumption has been that a more complete archive leads to more complete knowledge and therefore more complete control or grasp over a subject. In other words, the more comprehensive the data or information contained within an archive, the more sophisticated are assumed to be our methods of knowledge production, and more authoritative our comprehension of the object of knowledge. This presumption is something that I want to interrogate today. For many decades now, scholars working on Indian cinema have been lamenting the absence of adequate archives. In fact, our government has been promising us a film museum for the last 60 years, which we are all waiting with great enthusiasm to view at some point. Some of my own work is on early film history, so I'm acutely aware of these absences. Many of us have to find innovative ways of studying films that were made but are lost or destroyed, and therefore films we have never been actually able to see. In this context, I've been speculating about whether an archive must always be seen as a measure of comprehensiveness. And does this have to translate into the haves and the have-nots of film history, at least as far as the discipline of cinema and media studies are concerned? What happens when archives are incomplete? What happens when archives disobey? How do we make sense of the imperfect archive? The second proposition that I want to place before you is that of the uncontained archive. Archives that spill over and beyond their proper restricted space into everyday life. André Malraux's idea of a museum without walls helps us to think of these kinds of archives. What are the forms that historiography can take in the context of digital technology and semi-organized data that is constantly vanishing and reappearing in different locations? What happens to the idea of a historical document in light of what Henry Jenkins calls convergence culture, where we are both producers and consumers of media content? The fact that YouTube is now probably our largest online archive and that it is crowdsourced generates challenges and possibilities that we haven't had to grapple with in the context of the classical physical archive. In the Indian context, as I will go on to show in my presentation, this spilling over isn't just about technology, but also about the classification of different conceptions of time, or in other words, the relationship between historical time and technological time. In order to do so, I will have to take a brief detour via post-colonial historiography to lay out the significance of the history of history as it plays out in the Indian context, and I bear your patience in letting me get through this section, which is not at all related to cinema. According to the 16th century English philosopher Francis Bacon, history is the knowledge of objects determined by space and time, that is, knowledge provided by memory. It is remarkable that within 200 years of Bacon's ruminations on history, the British Empire had set out on the rather more limited enterprise of writing and thus creating the histories of their colonies, thereby allegedly endowing their subjects with a historical consciousness. This endeavor was strengthened by the efforts of European Orientalists such as the German scholar of Sanskrit Max Müller, who established the discipline of Indology, or the Swiss linguist Ferdinand de Saussure, who was also a professor of Sanskrit. It's not surprising that Western scholars and British governors did not discover many Indian texts on historiography. For example, the 10th century poet-critic Rajshekhar's extensive text Kavya Mimamsa, which lays out a typology of knowledge in which history or itihas, which is the Sanskrit term for history, includes both myth and legend, or the 11th century critic Bhoja's ideas about historiography being meaning-producing and hence necessarily sequential. These are both contradictory ideas, so there's a great deal of debate going on. European scholars had almost unquestioningly turned to ancient Sanskrit texts like the Vedas and Upanishads, even though Sanskrit had long ceased being the language of communication or scholarship, and modern Indo-Aryan languages had taken strong root from the 10th century onwards. Nonetheless, historical accounts were produced aplenty, usually following the narrative trajectory of describing an ancient golden age which gradually fell into despondency and awaited being rescued and restored to former glory. Writing such accounts fit well within the colonial project of constructing epistemological frameworks through which the colonies could be made familiar, measured, managed, and governed. In the process, living indigenous practices of thinking about the past were sidelined and subjugated to the tyranny of history proper. One example of this is that yesterday and tomorrow, or the past and the future, are represented by the same word, kal, in many Indian languages. For those who may not know this, there are 18 official scripts in India and 22 official languages, and all the scripts look radically different from each other. And languages, as we know, are not mere instruments for communication, but are representative of people's worldviews. The point I'm trying to make is that the fact that the past and the future are denoted by a single word in several Indian languages implies that continuity and overlap have defined the historical imagination of millions of people in the region. The word kal derives from the root word for time, which is kal, and this has given rise to the popular conception of time, and therefore history, as being cyclical, reinforced in cultural practices by the belief in reincarnation in both Hindu and Buddhist traditions. Under colonial rule, these fluid conceptions of time and history were force-fitted into the grid-like and teleological structure of the colonial archive, which emerged as an important site for governance. The fallacy and irony of the colonial archive, of course, lay in its utopian desire for completeness, which, as we know, is but a myth at best and oubli at worst. The archive is at all times partial and incomplete, just as historiography is. In a structural sense, absences are just as significant as presences are for the archive as well as for historiography, since it is between the play of absence and presence that meaning is generated. What I mean is that a completely complete archive would be just as terrifying as a completely rounded historiographical account, as these would merely play to the masculine colonial desire of total power, total control, and total subjugation. What you see in this slide is an image of the classical text or record-based archive on the left and an image of an indigenous pittora painting, which is actually a pictorial way of documenting history, as art historians have pointed out. So I argue that absences in historical accounts or in the archive may invoke our wrath at the lie of the archive and the lie of history. However, the completion of filling in of absences cannot by itself be the end point of the archive or of the archivist or of historiography. Rather, I propose that a kaleidoscopic approach to historiography, whereby we are able to rearrange available bits into new patterns, which show up the diversity of the world in a diversity of forms. This is especially crucial in the context of countries like India, where for a variety of reasons, including that we were colonized for the 200 years when Europe was busy setting up its archives, we do not have substantial film archives or institutions where information is held in a consolidated and organized form. As a consequence of this, one has to learn to pay heed to dispersed and unstable sites of information, turning to alternative, more speculative conceptions of historiography that allow a degree of uncertainty, perhaps in the form of a specter which lingers but cannot be fully grasped. So the first example that I want to share with you is from my own work on Fatma Begum, who was South Asia's first female director and producer. She was also a scriptwriter and an actor who was active in Indian cinema in the 1920s and 30s. I don't want to dwell too much upon the fact that she was the first female director and producer, because I think we place too much emphasis on those originary moments in film history. I've been attempting to explore Fatma Begum's work and life for over a decade now, and my explorations seem to have taken the shape of an ongoing probe, which is perhaps what Monica Dellasta and Jane Gaines embrace in their suggestion of constellating with women workers from earlier periods in film history as a durational investment. For those to whom Fatma is a stranger, let me very briefly introduce her. Fatma was one of the wives of the Prince of Sachin, which was a small princely state in the western part of India. She migrated to Bombay in the early 20th century. The date is uncertain, but my hunch is that it may have been around 1913, as this is the year listed as a year of death in the lineage documents of the prince's family. It would have been perceived as rather disgraceful for someone from a royal family to leave a husband, migrate to a big city and join the movies, and her family must have found it more convenient to disown her by declaring her dead. Fatma went to Bombay with her three daughters, and not much is known yet of her life in Bombay for about a decade, until in 1926, she set up a production house called Fatma Film Corporation, later renamed in 1928 as Victoria Fatma Film Corporation. The company had a brief lifespan of 4 years, producing just under a dozen films, none of which are available now, or one doesn't know where they were available at any point. She started directing and producing films and also acted in films along with her two daughters, who you can see here. Zubeda, on to your to your right and Sultana to your left. Zubeda was the lead actress in the first South Asian talkie film Alamara, and Sultana was apparently one of the highest paid actresses of the silent era in the 1920s. Fatma herself continued to act in films until 1938, after which she seems to have retired from the film industry. The story of a production house is no less exciting than a racy thriller. And one of my main sources of information have been the many court hearings reported in depth by newspapers about a number of charge sheets that had been filed against her. The hearings are covered in dramatic detail, and we learn that Fatma drove a Rolls Royce, lived on Carter Road, which is a posh area in Bombay, had a production house in Bandra, sat in court with her face lightly veiled, had defected on several payments, was briefly married to a man who probably attempted to take control of her studio, and possibly also instigated various individuals to file charge sheets against her. There were charges of fraud, forging of mortgage documents, the theft of a film printing machine, money taken from producers for films that were never completed, allegations of swindle, jewelry, and so on. More than anything, the legal cases were symptomatic of struggles of a woman with no history of making films, attempting to build a career in the industry at perhaps the most precarious phase in the history of cinema, which was a transition from silent films to the talkies. Fatma was born in the state of Sachin, and her husband, Ibrahim Muhammad Yaqub Khan III, was probably of Siddhi descent, as was Fatma herself. The Siddhis were East African migrants who were brought to India as soldiers and rose in political ranks, establishing two small kingdoms of their own, one of which was the state of Sachin. Thus, it turns out that the first female director of South Asian cinema was of East African descent. Many of these and other details revealed themselves to me gradually and over time, and the incompleteness of the narrative pushed me towards exploring alternative forms of writing history, which I first tried out as a fictional interview between Fatma Begum and a journalist called Miss Kitty, attempting to develop a character sketch while also providing a historical context which made me realize how difficult writing docufiction was. As I continue to constellate with Fatma, I'm inspired by the independent filmmaker and researcher Kamal Swaroop, who has spent almost a lifetime recovering the history of Dadasaheb Phalke, considered as the father of Indian cinema, having made the first full-length Indian film, Raja Harishchandra, in 1913. Swaroop's methodological approach, producing two films, a hefty book, and a website on the Phalke project, combines archival and film historical research with a science-type speculative recalling. Swaroop retraced Phalke's journeys across the various towns and cities he lived in, along with a group of students and filmmakers, visiting some of the important sites such as the JJ School of Art in Bombay, where Phalke studied, holding workshops with selected residents in each city to visualize an account of the director's life, recordings of which became part of his historiographical account, as I will show in the clip that I play for you.
The child Phalke reared in the ancient religious town of Trimbakeshwar, a town of temples and haunting ruins, attending katha sessions with his father, listening to the stories of Narasimhamurti, roaming around temples, gazing at the icons of the god with his friend Tilan.
एक एक्सपेरिमेंट अमेरिका में हो रहा है एक फोटोग्राफर है मेव ब्रिक
Phalke is shivering with cold, crying for his father in the dark.
You're trying to evoke certain ghosts of Phalke, that time, people, and that's why you're bringing it to places like this.
Phalke might have been...
One basic thing is that you need a genetic tradition or a tradition, or if you're not coming from a tradition and just entering into an art school, what is the difference?
Did you come from an artistic family?
Lumiere, the first time I had experienced this kind of movement, because it was definitely coming towards me.
One day during the shooting, Mandakini is making faces at herself in the mirror.
Her father directed
Phalke post in with the silent Setu Bandhan, which had been completed in 1931-32.
वर्ती युग में आने के बाद फिल्म बनाने का खर्च और पूरी मदद नहीं मिल पाने की वजह से वो कई साल बेकार थे। जेल देकर अपने जीवन की पहली और आखिरी फिल्म गंगा अवतरण 1937 में कोल्हापुर फिल्म के लिए तैयार की चिकने साहब शंकर बने थे और लीला जी पारन थे।
So let me return to my initial question about the relationship between historical time and technological time. What I mean by this is, in what way does the real time of history and years of a person's life or events belonging to another time exist within the time space of our own mediated forms? As you saw in that clip in the trailer there was footage from Phalke's original films, there was footage that Kamal Swarup had shot while doing his historical research, there was a collage from all kinds of media, news coverage and so on and so forth. So I'm really interested in this question of, you know, how does one look at the work of historiography or how does one bring the past into conversation with the present across different mediated forms? So what shapes can these mediating mediums take as historiographers and historians? And therefore, how do we account for these within the larger archive of moving image cultures which manifests across different temporalities and forms? Gilles Deleuze's notion of the time image, an image that is saturated with relationships between multiple points in time, allows us to think about the images in Swarup's film as bringing together the past and the present in the manner of evoking a spirit, a specter. A historian's job is not only to enter the recesses of the archive and go back in time, but to rescue parts of the past and bring them back into our own presence in the manner of a time traveler. But this is a risky endeavor in South Asia. As my next example, which is a quasi-historical film called Padmavat by Sanjay Leela Bhansali, released earlier in 2018, will show. Historical films have unfailingly given rise to controversies in India, and hardly has any historical film been released without allegations of misrepresentation or the sentiments of one community or another being hurt. Traditionally, in such situations, the Central Board of Film Certification has demanded cuts and revisions in films, and the CBFC, that's the Central Board, overstepping its remit as a certifying body to becoming the Censor Board, as it is popularly known, has been at the heart of a raging debate about the regulation of cinema and cinema audiences for a very long time now, from the early decade of the 20th century. The case of Padmavat is particularly poignant in our current socio-political climate in India for a number of reasons that we will not get into now, but I'm happy to discuss informally later. Padmavat is a fictional film based on an epic poem in the Awadhi language written in the 16th century by the Sufi poet Malik Muhammad Jayasi. The poem describes the conquest of a Muslim king, Alauddin Khilji, who was a real character from history, and his desire to possess the beautiful queen Padmavati, a fictional character invented by Jayasi, who later came to be worshipped in Rajasthani legend. Rajasthan is a part of the desert area in India. This poem was written roughly 225 years after Khilji's time. And while one would like to believe that the poet undertook rigorous historical research, Sufism, a mystical tradition that brought in Islam and Hinduism together, was more interested in the idea of love than in historical veracity. And all of you here are very familiar with Sufism. One of your great saints, Rumi, has had a tremendous influence on Sufi musical traditions in South Asia. By popular accounts, Jayasi is believed to have wanted to achieve the stature of the great poet Amir Khusrau, whose father incidentally was Turkish and his mother was Hindu, and Amir Khusrau established the tradition of classical Hindustani music in India and Pakistan, or what was then, whatever it was. Amir Khusrau, on whose epic poem Ishkiya, Padmavati was modeled. In this film, Khilji is depicted as a tyrannical Muslim conqueror, although his biographer suggests that while a great warrior, he was also a henpecked husband. In any case, the film caused a furore, and the chief ministers of at least three states in India declared that they would not allow it to be released, even if it was cleared by the censor board. Countrywide protests were led by Hindu fundamentalist outfit called the Karmi Sena, who claimed that the film insulted the people of Rajasthan, who worshipped Padmavati for having committed suicide or Jauhar to protect her honor when the Muslim king Khilji defeated her husband in battle and wished to take her captive. The reactions coming from all parts of the country, from politicians, film stars, the general public, were overwhelming. And the situation had got so absurd that the body of a 40-year-old trader, Chetan Saini, was found hanging off Alamgarh Fort in Rajasthan with a message engraved in stone next to his body that said, "Hum putle jalate nahi latkate hai," which translates as, "We do not burn effigies, we hang them." Effigies of the film's director had been burnt earlier that morning by the Karmi Sena, and although it is still unclear if Chetan Saini's death had anything at all to do with the film, the morbid curatorial intervention by way of the engraved message was chilling. I want to show you a little clip of a television news report, which will give you a more sort of immediate sense of the controversy.
There's a crisis in India, and it's called Padmavati.
Padmavati.
Padmavati. But who is Padmavati? It's not a name of a rape victim, a politician accused of corruption, or a deadly cyclone. It is a Bollywood film that has taken a nation of 1.3 billion people by storm. Padmavati is the story of a Hindu queen, Rani Padmini, played by actress Deepika Padukone, and her resistance against a Muslim king, Alauddin Khilji. The film portrays the 13th century Sultan of Delhi as a villainous, barbaric, and self-obsessed ruler. And that's what he probably looked like in real life. But it's not the Muslims who are unhappy with the inaccurate portrayal. The Hindus are up in arms about the depiction of a queen for a number of reasons, like the alleged portrayal of romance between a Hindu queen and a Muslim king, the glorification of a Muslim king, distortion of history, and hurting religious sentiments. The list goes on. And guess what? Nobody has even seen the film yet. But that hasn't stopped protests, lawsuits in the Supreme Court, people screaming on national television, physical assault on the filmmakers, and bounties being offered for chopping off the heads, legs, and other body parts of the lead actors. Another senior leader from the ruling Hindu Nationalist Party, the BJP, suggested that it was an international Muslim conspiracy.
Many of them, I won't say all of them, are being financed by people from Dubai in order to devalue and debase the Hindu resistance to Islam.
Did he actually just say that? Because let's get real, the Hindu queen probably didn't even exist in the first place. The film is loosely based on a 16th century poem, which tells the story of a queen who chose to self-immolate instead of being captured by a Muslim conqueror. So is India fighting over fiction? Here's the reality. Female infanticide still persists.
So, is India fighting over fiction? Now, it might be easy to write this episode off as a ludicrous response. However, it raises important questions about the peculiar relationship between history and the present. By the second half of the 20th century, the view that history was not a written-in-stone text belonging to some pristinely contained past had been widely accepted. The Holocaust had dented Europe's belief in the movement towards the future as being either optimistic or progressive. An overriding concern about how to make sense of the present or the contemporary guided much critical thought in the 20th century. For example, it was a sense of dismay about the historical present that marked Walter Benjamin's essay on the concept of history, where he suggests, to articulate the past historically does not mean to recognize it the way it really was. It means to seize hold of a memory as it flashes up at a moment of danger. Only that historian will have the gift of fanning the spark of hope in the past, who is firmly convinced that even the dead will not be safe from the enemy if he wins. Benjamin illustrates this through his discussion of Paul Klee's painting, The Angel of History, which depicts an angel back turned towards the future, looking upon the past, while a storm from paradise has been caught up in the angel's wings such that he can't close them and is therefore getting blown away into a future that he cannot see, while the rubble of history keeps piling up. Benjamin observes that where we see the appearance of a chain of events, the angel sees a single catastrophe. And while he would like to pause, awaken the dead and piece together what has been smashed, the storm prevents him from doing this while blowing him blindfolded into the future. The Padmavat case shows that Benjamin was right in his suggestion that even the dead will not be spared by the enemy, posing the question of how can we and to what end should we excavate figures from history or bring back the dead to life, so to speak. What is the nature of archival work and what place does the archive occupy in the context of constructing historical narratives in the present? My next and final example is the work of a visual artist from India, Nalini Malani, who extensively works with video and who has obsessively been evoking figures from history to address feminist concerns. Nalini Malani is one of India's foremost feminist artists, and her work has been shown extensively in international exhibitions, including in Documenta 13 in Kassel and at the Centre Pompidou in Paris and in several other places. I'm bringing in Malani's work here, which strictly speaking belongs to the discipline of art history, since as I mentioned at the start of my presentation, I'm broadly interested in the moving image, and Malani has devised an innovative form which she calls the video shadow play, which takes us back to the fundamental premise of the possibilities of projecting moving images into and across time and space. The video shadow play consists of a combination of rotating plastic cylinders made of mylar, which you can see there in that image, made of mylar or Lexar, that are reverse painted, along with video projections, sound and performance. These create immersive works in large space, installed in large spaces, drawing the viewer participant bodily and affectively into the work. And when there was a discussion of making the museum experiential this morning, you know, I was thinking of these images. So the viewer can never really see the image completely. Part of it falls on the viewer's body. The cylinders rotate and the videos flow through them. There is movement in multiple directions at varying speeds, and the ensemble is quite scattered and chaotic. This sets up a mode of being and seeing together. To give just one example, Remembering Mad Meg is a work that Malani did in 2007, and it was a site-responsive work exhibited in a long corridor of the Irish Museum of Modern Art in Dublin, which was originally the Royal Hospital Kilmainham, a military hospital founded in 1684 by James Butler, Duke of Ormond and Viceroy to Charles II, as a home for retired soldiers. The irony of a military hospital also functioning as a home for retired soldiers in colonial Ireland is not lost. But in the long and narrow exit corridor, 8 mylar cylinders were hung one after another with 2 videos projected on them from the side, casting images onto the white hospital walls. In this work, Mad Meg is rescued from an original context in the 16th century Dutch and Flemish artist Peter Bruegel's oil painting, who depicted her as a furious, violent, foolish, and mentally disturbed woman running into the mouth of hell. I can't point towards that image, but I hope you can spot where Meg is towards the center of the image. Malani relocates Meg, placing her alongside other representative figures of women. These include Mother India, Sita from the Indian epic Ramayana, Bertolt Brecht's Mother Courage, Lewis Carroll's Alice, a girl with a leg blown up in an explosion, a mechanical doll with dead eyes, and so on. Quotation is a method frequently employed by Malani to locate her work in dialogue with objects, images, events, and ideas from elsewhere and another time. According to the art critic Geeta Kapoor, Malani uses quotation in multiple ways: to insert the image and ideology of an artist and make a direct comment on it, to use the image as impersonation, to cite drawing conventions, to copy and improvise for her own purpose. In this work, Meg, running alongside a hound, is projected onto a large red circle and is painted in shades of black and grey in a Kaligat style, which is a vernacular style of painting from Bengal with a flat perspective. Malani draws our attention here to the persistence of misogyny and the relationship between madness and war. Much of Malani's work can be located within the tension between remembrance and erasure, bringing the past into dialogue with the present rather than to memorializing it is an impetus that marks most of her shadow plays. The artist frequently addresses issues such as historical trauma, violence, colonialism, and gender-based oppression, quoting history or mythology through iconic and representative characters removed from the original context and facilitating what Michael Rothberg calls an affective multidirectional memory. This raises a question of what it means to extract a figure from history and make her visible again, and takes us to a key point about Malani's shadow plays, which is a belief in the thought image. The thought image implies that the work of imagination and imaging is crucial to the production of thought. The form of the shadow plays is central to this act of imaging or imagination. As Andreas Hussein states, shadows have pedagogic and epistemological value. Rather than confronting us with naked and transparent truth, they stimulate the visual imagination to fill in the gaps of that which is not or barely visible, a process that can lead to insecurity and productive ambiguity. I'm going to show you a little clip from Malani's work. So I'm going to end my presentation by reiterating the point that I began with, which is that when both time and history as conceptual categories are experienced and imagined differently in different cultures, how can our methodological and theoretical engagements with archives and historiography better reflect these differences? And how do we do justice to these plural imaginaries when we set up our film archives and museums and when we write our film histories? Thank you. Yeah, I think the point I was trying to make is that language is a very rich resource in terms of understanding our conceptualization of various things. And the fact that the word for yesterday and tomorrow is the same word. In fact, it's very interesting. I lived in Ireland for 11 years and I was learning Irish. I failed, of course, miserably, but I gave it a shot. And I discovered that there are two words for I in Irish. There is a permanent I and there's a temporary I. And that for me was fascinating, to be able to think of subjectivity in such a nuanced way, in that it is, you know, it can be temporary and it can also be permanent. And I think some of these clues that language has for us can be quite interesting in terms of thinking about how we actually conceptualize time. I mean, you know, we've all read about Bergson, what Bergson has to say about time and experiential time and mechanical time. But how do these things actually play out in people's lived lives? And I think we've kind of, I gave that whole long prelude about colonial history and the colonial archive, because that was unfortunately India's introduction to the archive. You know, that was our experience, and not my generation, but my grandparents' generation, of the archive. And so, to me, it is almost sort of a political project to say that, well, you know, archives are not complete or should not be complete, and let them be incomplete, and give us some space to speculate, to interject, to blow our own stories into these spaces. Because that in a way is kind of exposing what we all know is the lie of absolute truth and, you know, document-based, veracity-based narratives of history. And I think we've lost some of those traditions, especially now in the era of surveillance, constant surveillance, where everything is data. Everything has to be proved. So I think I'm interested in these kind of questions of how does one actually move away from this documentary evidence and writing history based on that.
Thank you for your presentation. This was intriguing, also very insightful. I wanted to ask, or actually talking about religion also, when we discuss archive, and let's say them, I'm from Nigeria and we have like one of the largest movie industry. So most of our movies, for example, the archive, the movies that we have in the archive are, for example, Lost Glories of, let's say, the God of Thunder, of the God of, let's say, Rain or something like that, or Witches, which is coming back now to haunt the Nigerian film industry, because a lot of people see, let's say, some talented or, let's say, special kids as witch and stuff like this. So what is your take on this kind of, does the archive, let's say, has this feeling of a lost glory, and people are trying to find those glories, or what is your take on that, like, basically?
I mean, I think it's something that we all struggle with, to not slip into a nostalgic mode. But it's difficult, you know, like I said, I've been working on this filmmaker called Fatma Begum, about whom I could find very little information, and I have to keep sort of checking myself from time to time and saying that you can't get too close to her, you can't fall in love with her, you have to keep her objective distance. But it's an ego, it's a tightrope walk, I think, and ultimately, it's a subjective recounting, and that's what I'm interested in some way. Thank you all for listening so patiently and not falling off to sleep through the entire duration of the talk.
Thank you so much, Rashmi.
Thank you.
Amazing.